Hello, hello, Mordimers here, and welcome to another game played in the Legends of Chess online tournament organized by Chess24.com platform as a part of Magnus Carlsen Chess Tour. And this time I would like to show you the game between Magnus Carlsen, who's gonna play as white, and Anish Giri, who's gonna play, of course, as black. And we've seen already plenty of games between these two, so I'm not gonna introduce them one more time. If you are interested, check the game before on my channel. So without further ado, let's see what happened on the board, because this is pretty interesting. We have d4 by Magnus Carlsen, knight on f6, c4, e6, knight on f3, d5, queen's gambit declined, knight on c3, and now bishop on b4. So Anish Giri went for something what is very, very stable, very safe. And he already lost a couple of games where he was, you know, catch out of the book. But it's very difficult to imagine to play something fancy in the Rogozin defense. So Magnus Carlsen goes for the main line, bishop on g5. We have h6, kicking the bishop. And here most of the players just take the knight. Of course, you know, playing bishop on h4, it's still okay. So these moves are well known, but Magnus didn't play any of that. And you could imagine that Magnus go for something new, like bishop on f4, as he played bishop on f4 plenty of times, also against Anish Giri. But no, Magnus Carlsen went for bishop on d2. Very shocking move, but if you think for a while, you can understand why. And actually, we had a couple of games played with the bishop on d2. Castle by Anish Giri, and now e3. This is the main move. So this is how it looks like. It looks pretty solid for both sides. However, Magnus Carlsen played another shocking move, g4. And he was asked in the interview, why did you play that move? Is it possible in this opening? And he said it's all about, you know, playing g4 in every opening and trying. Yeah, and actually the idea is very simple. Of course, black cannot take the pawn, I mean can take the pawn, however rook g1, and this attack can be just, you know, tremendous, very dangerous for black, and it's probably unplayable. So of course Anish Giri didn't take it, but play bishop on c3, moving this bishop from this diagonal, and after bishop on c3, knight e4, attacking the bishop on c3, but also controlling g5. So g5 is controlled 3 times, so white actually cannot push the pawn. And Magnus thought for a while, and he played queen on c2, and here Anish Giri should play probably something like knight on d7, just, you know, support the maybe c5 move in the future, maybe even watching on f6. However, for now it would be pretty risky. However, he played c5 immediately, so he want to open the position because white king is still in the center, so that's, you know, pretty logical. We have d takes on c5, and now b6. So sacrificing the pawn for the development. And now c takes on b6. Magnus could go for that. However, after queen on b6, black would have some initiative, you know, for now watching on f2. So some move like e3 would have to be played, but then bishop on b7, putting bishop on this diagonal, and black could get quite a lot of activity. But Magnus is not interested in that. He want to have initiative. And if he plays something, you know, like h4, maybe h5, g5, it's a pretty slow move. Also, you know, rook on g1 and pushing the pawn, this is also pretty slow. He played g5 immediately. And he also said in the interview that was the only chance for Anish Giri to play actually h5. And the engine actually confirmed that h5 is the best in this position. And let's say after c takes on b6, queen on b6, just continue in the same fashion like I show you, e3, bishop on b7, bishop on g2, and knight on d7. Everything is fine with this position. White also have to think where to put the king, you know, how to continue the game. White is probably slightly better, but it's, you know, nothing much. And it's very difficult to open the king side by white to, you know, to continue the attack. However, After g5, Anish Giri went for h takes on g5, and from now on Magnus Carlsen just got the advantage. So h4 immediately, and now g4, trying to not open the, you know, more files, and now knight on g5. And what to play now? Knight on g5 would be, you know, a really bad idea, because after knight on g5, h takes on g5, and look at this. This just looks bad. So you cannot play like something like g6, because this is a checkmate, as the bishop already is on the long diagonal. And if you play something like f5, you still are in the trouble. G takes on f6, let's say rook on f6, queen on h7, king f7, and just simply, you know, bishop on f6, queen f6, and let's say bishop on g2, moving the bishop on this diagonal, and it's so bad position for black. It's actually completely unplayable. So definitely taking the knight is cannot be just played. We have f5, so solidifying this this pawn structure. However, it's still very, very shaky. We have bishop on g2, improving the position, and also look at this bishop. It's pretty nasty now, and black has to be very, very careful. We have b takes on c5, and now castle on the queen side. And now not only this bishop works on the long diagonal, but also look at this pin. So it's pretty dangerous here, and it's very difficult to make any decision. For example, it looks like, okay, I can win the exchange. However, that would be one of the worst moves in the position, because after c takes on d5, yes, you can win the exchange. However, after bishop on h1, your position, you know, all of these diagonals, even the queen can come here, it's just bad. It's just bad. It's just unplayable, especially with this bishop. The knight still on g5, it's completely dangerous, and black didn't, you know, develop any pieces yet. According to the engine, knight on c6 could be the best option for black. It's still, you know, not really great, because, for example, c takes on d5, e takes on d5, and now knight on e4, and after f takes on e4, for example, bishop on e4, and look at this. It's still a very active position of white pieces. However, black could probably survive this. So this would be the best option, actually, to play by white. However, Anish Giri didn't want to risk, and he just exchanged this very strong knight in the center. Actually, as you see, it could be removed, and play knight on g5. H takes on g5, queen on g5 with tempo, with check, so king on b1. And here, actually, what Anish achieved, he got out from this nasty pin. So there is no pin here, but there is still pin here on this diagonal. We have knight on d7, and c takes on d5 by Magnus Carlsen, and this position is extremely dangerous. For example, and now black cannot keep the pawn, because black are pawn up. However, e takes on d5 is losing. It's just, you know, checkmate in 9 moves. Bishop on d5, rook on f7, queen on b3. You see already this attack, this rook is joining. So queen on g6, defending the rook. And after bishop on f7, queen on f7, rook h8. And this is all, you know, queen on f7, knight on f6, defending, rook h1, and after knight on h7, bang, this is a checkmate, as this bishop is extremely dangerous here. So it's not possible even to take that pawn. Also, pushing the pawn doesn't work for the same reason. Just d6, opening this diagonal, opening this diagonal, it looks pretty bad. Black can try to close one of the diagonals, but still, queen on b3, rook on f7, and now rook on h8, the same motifs, king h8, all of them are still, you know, on the table. Knight on f6, rook h1, and again, this is just checkmate in couple of moves. So it's not even possible to do anything in the center. This is why Anish Giri goes for knight on b6, so he gives back the material. We have d takes on e6 with the attack on the rook, and now is the question, try to save the exchange or maybe not. If Anish tries to save, for example, rook on b8, then white can the simplest way to win is actually just double the rooks, and after bishop on e6, you know, bring another rook to the h file, and this is extremely dangerous attack. Black has to be very precise, and it's probably impossible actually to continue the game. This bishop watching on g7, this is just very, very dangerous, and you will see in the game how dangerous it can be. So after d takes on e6, Anish went for bishop on e6, sacrificing the exchange, and now bishop on a8, rook on a8, and queen on d2. Quite shocking move. Magnus Carlsen had much better moves. However, he just want to exchange, you know, the queens, simplify the game, and then win, being, you know, exchange up, just he want to win. And this was probably the best chance for Anish Giri to actually exchange the queens. And try to play that. It's not easy, definitely it's not easy. However, these three pawns can be very dangerous, you know. White cannot stop very easily. So that was probably his chance. But Anish decided not to exchange the queens and played queen on g6. We have queen on d6, very active move. And now f4 with check. King on a1, and as f4 pawn now is without defense, so Anish Giri wanted to reinforce this and play rook on f8, and actually this is a huge blunder. This is the biggest blunder in this game. What he should play is something like rook on e8. Give up this pawn, so for example queen on f4, and continue like knight on d5 maybe. Queen on e5, these motifs, this was played by Magnus Carlsen. He wanted, you know, to build the battery here. However, now knight on c3, queen on c3, and the game could continue here. As you see, it's very difficult for black without this pawn on f4. These double pawns are very weak, and white probably wouldn't have any problems, for sure wouldn't have any problems to win. However, as I said, rook on f8 is a huge blunder. So feel free to pause the video and find forced checkmate in fourth move while I enjoy my cup of tea. Okay, ready? I believe everybody found it. It's not very complicated. So rook on h8, check. And this is all forced. King on h8. Queen on f8 with check, king h7, that was easy part. Rook on h1, this is also easy part. And after queen on h6, maybe you could miss something like queen on g7. However, this queen is of course pinned, so this is a checkmate. Quite well-known pattern, and Magnus Carlsen just missed that. He didn't go for this checkmate because his mind was just fixed on the g7. He wanted to play on g7. This is why he played queen on e5. We have g3, so Anish Giri want to actually create his passed pawn. We have f takes on g3, and now instead of playing f takes on g3, which was the best move in the position, so the first idea was just great, he didn't play that. F takes on g3, he should play that, and now this pawn can be quite dangerous. So for example rook d on g1, but now g2, and this rook cannot go to h2 because black has this beautiful attack, and you know, exploit the weakness on the first rank. So what white would have to find is rook on g2, and after queen on g2, queen e6, and now after rook on f7, rook d1, and the rook has to attack from this side. And yes, white stands slightly better and probably has the winning position. But it's still a lot to play in this position, and you know, material wise the position is equal. Of course white has a lot of more initiative and threats, and position of black king is just bad. However, we didn't have f takes on g3. Anish Giri went for knight on c4 with the attack on the queen. And here Magnus missed the opportunity again. Queen on c5, watching at f8, and this is again the same pattern, you know, mating pattern with the rook on h1. So he had the chance to play that. Black would be forced actually to play something like rook on c8. And after queen on e7, rook on d8 is unstoppable. If you move, for example, the queen, on e8, then of course queen on g7 is a checkmate, so that's not possible. So for example, knight on e3, but then rook on d8, rook on d8, queen on d8, king on f7, and let's say queen on c7, queen g8, queen b8, white actually can clean up a bit here, and after queen on b8, let's say take also this pawn and win the knight and of course the game, and this is of course completely winning for white, especially, you know, after taking the knight. So that was the opportunity. However, Magnus was fixed on the exchanging the queens and also on the attack on g7. So we have queen on h5, and here Anish Giri doesn't have much choice and has to exchange the queens. So we have queen on h5, rook on h5, and now knight on e3, attacking the rook, rook on g1. And here bishop on f5, and Magnus has to be very careful because now there are some ideas on the first rank still in the air. So Magnus want to be very, very safe and played b3, making a, you know, a breathing spot for the king. We have f takes on g3. Now rook takes on g3, of course, works very well. Bishop on g4, attacking the rook. Rook on c5, and now rook on f1. And as you see, that would be a checkmate. So, and now we have king on b2, and after knight on d1, king a3, knight on c3, Magnus didn't take the knight, but he took the bishop. And in this position, Anish Giri resigned. So, interesting game, especially this g4. This g4 was completely novelty, and it's very difficult to find, you know, novelty in Rogozin. Rogozin defense was played in 2020 plenty of times, one of the most popular openings, and Magnus found, you know, g4 in the 7 move, and was joking. G4 should be, you know, tried in the every opening, because why not? Maybe it's gonna work. And as you see here, it works very, very well, and yeah, Magnus won. Even he missed this, you know, first checkmate in first move. In the interview, he said that is more than embarrassing for him, but overall he doesn't care much, because, you know, he got a very good position and he just won this game. Black has nothing to do here. Knight is under attack and has to move, so knight on e2. And now after rook on e4, have to, you know, jump on the king side, and after, let's say, rook on a4, this pawn gonna fall, and white gonna have very easy game with these two connected passed pawns. Of course, is completely winning for white. So this is why Anish Giri resigned. So I would like to show you also what happened in other matches. So as you see, Vladimir Kramnik, he lost in the Armageddon game. This is why he has 1 point and Jan Nepomniachtchi 2 points. And Anish Giri lost two of the games. So Magnus Carlsen got 3 points. Vishy Anand, I just show you this game. If you haven't seen that, check it there. And lost to Peter Svidler. Very dramatic game. And that was, you know, roller coaster. So Vishy had the winning position, then he just, you know, didn't see the blunder of Peter Svidler, then he blundered, and that was also amazing. 3 points for Peter Svidler. Peter Leko also won in the Armageddon, so 2 points, and 1 point for Vasyl Ivanchuk. And Boris Gelfand, huge surprise, he won two games against Ding Liren and got 3 points. And standings: Boris Gelfand, Magnus Carlsen, Peter Svidler 3 points, Peter Leko, Jan Nepomniachtchi 2 points, Vasyl Ivanchuk, Vladimir Kramnik 1 point, and Vishy Anand, Anish Giri and Ding Liren no points. But today they gonna play another round, so we gonna see another games. And if you like this video, press like. If for some reason you don't like it, press unlike, and don't forget to subscribe. Smash the bell button. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.